You're listening to the Sketchnote Army Podcast. I'm your host, Mike Rohde, the author of the Sketchnote Handbook and the Sketchnote Workbook, and this is the podcast where I chat with sketchnoters and visual thinkers and try to understand what makes them tick. This episode of the Sketchnote Army Podcast is brought to you by the Sketchnote Ideabook, the sketchbook designed for sketchnoters. Equipped with a no-bleed, no-show-through paper, the Sketchnote Ideabook can take almost any marker or pen you can throw at it. Learn more at sketchnoteideabook.com. And now, on with the show. In this episode, I talk with Krisztina Szerovay about her winding journey that led her from practicing law into design, user experience, and then sketchnoting. She talks about her work sharing user experience concepts as sketchnotes in this interesting interview. Welcome, everyone, to the show. I'm excited to have Krisztina here. Krisztina Szerovay, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Mike, for having me. It's really great to be on the show.
It's wonderful to have you. I have seen you around the internet, and I've been following the work you're doing. I really think it's wonderful work. You are sketching for UX on Instagram. I know that you've written Medium articles, and I'm sure we'll talk about all these things. You came to my attention because of that, and I really liked the work that you did and the way you explained the space where I work, which is user experience. And I thought this would be a really fun person to have on the show. So here you are. So tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do.
Okay, thanks. So I have several roles and labels. And for example, in my professional life, I am a UX researcher and designer, and I lead a UX researcher team at a Hungarian bank. And I also organize internal education, and I teach different teams inside the bank. For example, 2 days ago, I had a UX writing workshop. And my other frequently used label is that I consider myself a UX teacher and mentor. I have 2 courses on Udemy. And, Yeah, and one is about sketching for UX designers, and the other one is about development fundamentals, also for UX designers. And I teach at several offline courses, for example, at UI Academy or User Interface Academy. And here I teach data visualization. And I, as you mentioned, I publish UX-related content quite regularly. I have more than 100 UX knowledge-based sketches, and I have several mentees too. And as for my private life, I live with my husband, and we have a 12-year-old Hungarian Vizsla dog. And I love board games and video games. And of course, I am passionate about sketching and visual thinking. So yeah, this is me in a nutshell. And yeah, you also asked about my journey.
Yeah.
And how I became a visual thinker.
I think it's an interesting one too. I think people will love to hear this transition that you made to where you are now.
Yeah, so the visual thinking journey is different from the UX designer journey a little bit. So as for the visual thinking journey, I think that sketching has always been a big part of my life. So of course, I didn't use this label, visual thinker, but for example, during secondary school or my university studies, I always applied little drawings and icons and arrows and other connector lines to support the meaning of my notes I took during the lectures. And even before the secondary school, I remember that I created a lot of comic books and custom board games with my brother. We even designed additional levels to the platformer game Prince of Persia. And of course, I use sketching as a UX designer a lot. I created my sketching for UX course in 2017. And I wanted to share my knowledge and experience about this approach because, as you may very well know, many designers or UX designers start their design process inside a digital tool. And I wanted to show why sketching is a very efficient way and that it has so much potential So, for example, it gives you freedom to ideate and externalize your ideas quickly. And you are just not attached to your original ideas. It's really easily throwable or disposable if you don't like it, or you can quickly sketch out alternatives. This is a little bit connected to my other journey, of course, because I graduated as a lawyer, and during my legal PhD studies, my research was about the usability of e-government websites and case law databases. So I was able to study UX and usability in a legal doctoral program. So it was a great sort of hack. And after graduation, my brother showed me the book Don't Make Me Think by Steve Krug.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And back in, I think, 2009, I attended a web designer course, an online web designer course, and I learned Photoshop and Illustrator and so on. And then I just transitioned to UX design slowly, year by year. I attended courses and read a lot of book. And at one point, I became a freelancer. I had a lot of projects, and now I am at the enterprise UX design journey. We are in the middle of a design-driven transformation inside the bank. So, yeah.
And that's challenging. I work in a large corporation as well. So, I mean, probably not so different of an environment. Lots of siloing, lots of all those challenges. So in some ways, I feel like it took my whole career for me to get ready for this kind of a challenge, right? Because in some ways, it's real easy to do good UX inside of a startup, right? Because nothing exists, but the challenge is doing it inside of a institution with very standardized norms and way things go. And to challenge that is often a long-term process, right?
Just about introducing new processes and changing the existing mindset and culture. And it's a very interesting journey for me so far.
Something that struck me was, in some ways, I see you, that both parts of you in your story. On the one hand, you were a lawyer, so you did your good due diligence to research your way into a new position. Like once you discovered that okay, there's usability problems, and you found out there's actually a profession that focuses on this, then you started to do research and take classes. But the other half is the experience, you know, that you're very much into the experience side of things, right? So you use the experiencing to sort of work your way into that position, even being willing to do, you know, independent work as a freelancer so that you could transition. So really interesting story.
Yeah, and it wasn't a structured curriculum, you know. I didn't attend a university course like a human-computer interaction course or something like that. It was really a step-by-step flow.
So if you're coming from the experience of a lawyer, of an attorney, there's definitely some detail orientation and focus areas, right? What do you think that has benefited you, I guess, in UX, but also in your sketchnoting? Because I can, now that you mentioned that, I can totally see it. So tell me, what are the benefits that gives you?
Yeah, these two words are really closely related, but it's not that apparent. So I have never worked as an attorney. I worked as a codificator. It's a special word for someone who reviews legal drafts and writes legal rules. And so, as you can imagine, the whole legal system and the whole system of these interconnected rules is a huge, complex system with many, many little parts that relate to each other in many ways. And so this system thinking and the attention to the little details and being very, very consistent and, you know, each word has a distinct meaning. And so all these characteristics are very useful for me in this UX design profession. UX design is also about complex systems and consistency and little details. So it's basically the same.
Mm-hmm. And you could argue that sketchnoting and visual thinking in some ways is the same, right? Because you want consistent, the more consistent and the more details you notice, the more you're going to pick up and sort of capture that experience, whatever it might be, whatever the source might be.
Yeah, right. And you use these little building blocks, your visual library to construct sketchnotes. Yes.
In some ways, you know, the codifier, I think that was what you talked about. It reminded me that in the law, certain words have more meaning than they may appear. So for a layperson, when you see a paragraph of legal jargon, I guess, because often you can't penetrate what it means. To us, it just looks like, you know, a paragraph of words. But to someone who's in the law profession, you would actually, like, each word would have, like, another layer hidden behind it, right? So you, when you unpack it, like, a paragraph might turn into, you know, 12 pages of description, right? In some ways, I see a connection to sketchnoting, because what we're doing is we're taking lots of information and assumptions and impressions, and we're pouring them into little drawings and sometimes little words. So what might on the surface look like a single page of lettering and icons and drawings and such and handwriting actually could expand again into a 12-page discussion if you really wanted to deconstruct it in that way, which is really fascinating, the correlation between those two.
I've never thought about that, but you are right. Both in the sketchnoting world and in the legal world, we use little shortcuts, and everything has other layers of meanings, and sketchnoting is about distilling the most important concepts and information about something. And yes, when I write a legal rule, I do the same thing. I distill the most important things, and it's really not about fluffing. There is no unnecessary words inside it, and I think a sketchnote is really similar.
In a lot of ways, you have to be a good editor to sort of know that's just a little bit too much. I can remove that word and it will still have the same meaning, right? Like in some ways, like almost in writing text, to really get a really tight sentence where you can appreciate a good writer in the way they can use words that mean more than they look on the page, but then the economy of like not doing too much. Although there's definitely a relationship there.
And it's like UX writing too. Like you have to carefully select your words you shouldn't add any unnecessary sentences, because the user wants to focus on his or her goal and doing his or her job on the interface.
I guess that's true if you step back and look at any great thing. Like I'm thinking now of really great food. So when you go to a really expensive restaurant, a lot of what you're paying for is the experience of the chef to provide an experience, right? You're trusting them to be really great editors. So when you go to like some of the best meals, and I haven't been to many fancy restaurants, but one we had was multi-course. Each course was small. We went into it thinking, oh, we're going to have to go somewhere afterwards to fill up, because there's no way this is going to fill us up. And yet, after 10 courses, and they were small, we were totally satisfied. And it was something about the editing and the decisions about what do I include and what do I not include, and how strong should this part be versus that part, like all the balancing and all those details, same kind of thing, right? You're not using words now. You're now using food and flavor and aroma, right? It's so you, in some ways, it's a human thing to do this at a high level. And you're just the building blocks that you're using switch from words to, in some cases, drawings, and then to food objects. And you can do this, I imagine, at any in any level, right? It's a matter of the taste and editing and decision making that is often invisible to regular people when you see that, oh, you know, that's easy for someone to do that, when actually at the very highest levels, it takes a lot of work to make it look simple.
Yeah, and it's also about being intentional or intentionality. So when you create a sketchnote or a visual explanation, you decide what to include and what to leave out. And that way you can really just emphasize the most meaningful parts.
So, yeah, that's fascinating.
I just came to my mind that I'm sure that you know the book Understanding Comics by Scott.
Oh, yes.
And there is a concept in that book that, you know, in real life, for example, we have a photograph and then we can draw a circle with two dots and a line and it's a smiley. Mm-hmm. And he says that that when we create a sketch or a cartoon, it's a simplification process. Mm-hmm. And we eliminate everything we don't need so that we can focus on the most important parts and the specific characteristics. And this is the same way caricatures work. So by creating a sketch or a sketch note, we can amplify what is really important in that given context. And maybe it's the same with food. You mentioned that they intentionally amplify the best tastes and aromas. Mm-hmm.
Or the clash of tastes or the combination of tastes that you would never imagine to put together, and yet they're amazing, right? That's the joy of it. Mm-hmm. So what drew you to do all this work in sketchnoting and UX and sketching in UX? What was it that drew you to that? Mm-hmm. And why did you choose to, like, obviously you're an educator, I can tell by just the way that you operate and what you're doing.
Yeah.
But obviously it's a lot of work that you're doing extra that you don't have to do. All this training and teaching and helping others and visualizing with sketchnoting UX concepts. What drew you to that approach?
Yeah. So deep down, I always wanted to be a teacher, not as a primary profession, but I always valued knowledge sharing. And my mother is a teacher, and three of my aunts are also teachers, and one of my grandmother. My brother was a lecturer at the university, so they really inspired me. And in 2016, I attended a meetup about how to teach online. And the speaker was one of my friends, István Szép, and he's a graphic designer and lecturer. And he also has many courses on Udemy. And he presented about the different opportunities of teaching online. For example, he told us the benefits and downsides of using Udemy. And during the meetup, I just decided that no matter what, I am going to try out this online teaching thing. And later that year, in October, I attended a graphic facilitation training by an Estonian visual thinker, Kati Orav. I don't know if you heard about her. And right after that graphic facilitation training, I realized that I've always been a visual thinker, but secondly, I also realized that I apply visual thinking every day as a UX designer. So I sketch out processes and user flows. I create wireframe sketches. I draw storyboards and so on. So it's just, you know, clicked. I decided that, okay, this should be the topic of my first online course. And it was a strange time. I couldn't really sleep for days, and I designed the whole course structure, and I also decided one key point that I wanted my students to be able to draw along with me. So I also started thinking about how can I record my hands. So I didn't professional studio, of course. My setup was really clumsy, or I don't know what's the right word. I used a desk lamp with a flat head, so I could put the phone, my cell phone, on the top of it. And I bought nano pads to make the phone sort of stick on the top of the flat head of the lamp. And I also used a floor standing lamp. So it wasn't professional in any way, but according to the students' feedback, they really like that they can follow along with me throughout the whole course. And I don't use any presentation slides. I just draw as I talk about the concepts.
Which is really draws you in for sure.
Yes, it's very engaging. And so, this is how I started this. And Yeah, and next to the course, I also started a newsletter and a 100-day-long UX visual library building challenge. Mm. And I also started creating my UX knowledge base sketches. Mm-hmm. And creating these sketches for 2 years has been one of the most consistent things in my entire life. I did one sketch every week. And after 100 of these, I finished the series. But now I am creating little sketches I call UX knowledge piece sketches, mm-hmm. and I use little dotted sticky notes, and I draw my UX concepts on these sticky notes and post-its. So yeah, this constant knowledge sharing just became a big part of my life.
It seems like it's just part of your personality and maybe your upbringing, right? If your mother and your family, all these teachers surrounding you, you sort of live in this, in a bath of teaching, mm-hmm. and it's just the way you operate. So, mm-hmm. you know, you keep talking about all these ways that you're teaching. It's like, you know, so much that you're doing, but it probably feels natural for you for the most part.
Yes.
I suppose there's probably those weeks when you had a rough week and you're like, do I really have to draw another one of these things? Okay, I should probably do it, you know.
Yeah.
And how many are you up to? So you talked about doing the first 100. Mm-hmm. Do you have in your head the number of where you are right at this moment?
So I created 100 of these A4 size sketches I call knowledge-based sketches. And now I created 16 of these smaller ones.
The small ones.
Yeah, And I'm planning to publish a coffee table book that contains all of my sketches.
Oh, wonderful.
So that people can flip through it and just check out some of the concepts.
Well, I'd like to be one of the first ones to buy that book when it comes out. So that would be awesome. I think all my colleagues would love it in the office whenever we get back to the office.
Well, thank you.
Interesting. Well, it's really great to hear the way you're expressing yourself. Not only those things, but I see you've written Medium articles. So, I mean, it just sort of comes out of you in all different ways, which is great to see. And it sounds like you have students who give you feedback.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that I was going to mention, you talked about having sort of this piece together system to shoot your course. Like, I feel like that in this Corona time when I've been doing much more online teaching, like I'm just accepting all kinds of these opportunities because they're fun.
Yeah.
And I want to move in this space. Like you were sort of drawn to do these online courses. I'm sort of drawn to these live events, and I find them really fascinating opportunities to experiment. And so you've probably seen some photos on Instagram of my hacked together systems, right?
Awesome.
Makes you feel, you know, like, okay, I'm not the only one. I think that it's a lot more common. As a UX designer, I just am always in the mindset of let's build prototypes and see what works, and then I can finalize, you know, at some future time.
Yeah, so you can iterate. Yes.
Yes, exactly. It's just a provisional experiment, and you learn from everyone that you do. And for a long time, I was using an iPad, and I realized, hey, I could just I'm not using my phone, and it's a lot easier to hang over the desk. And so, but I haven't finalized my setup yet. I've been thinking about having a separate desk for it just so that I can leave everything alone. You know, all the lights and everything can be set up and I just sit down and work. Right now it's still sort of half working desk, half video desk. So it's definitely a challenge. Have you, when you do more of these video courses or trainings or things, if you're still doing them, do you still use the same setup or have you upgraded your setup for that?
Oh, I have added some new parts to my course in the last 3 years, and I use the same process and the same setup. For example, I added one part about the Gestalt principles because these are a great way to give students a sketching practice activity. I show these principles by using UI sketches. And I also added one part about how sketching can be used during a UX design process. Mm. And I try to keep the course consistent, you know. So if I could create a higher quality part, but then it would really stand out. Wouldn't fit. In a negative way. Yeah.
Yeah, it stays consistent, which I think is more important. And I think the thing that I observe too is people can get really hung up on the technical quality. And of course, you have to have a certain base level of quality. Like if your camera was blurry, it wouldn't really work, right? So there has to be some minimum quality level you have to start with. But after that, you know, like I think you can get really hung up on making everything so perfect that you're forgetting about the content. And I think what you're discovering was even with those basic structures in place, it communicated what you wanted to communicate, which is really great that you discovered that so quickly.
Yeah, and I wanted to make it so the whole sketching process to make it look more approachable, like they can do it. It's not a professional studio thing. You can just sit down and start sketching. So maybe this setup helped me to help me to make it more approachable. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like Krisztina is just like me, right? She's using her desk and she's just drawing. Like you, I think the beauty of that is at some point you forget about the quality as long as it's at, again, at that minimum level. Now you're just focusing on the content and the teaching and what you're saying and how you're applying it. Like the focus, it pushes the focus back on the student and their work and not so much on, oh, isn't Krisztina's table so beautiful and the lights are so bright?
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Like that's immaterial to the teaching, right? So that's really good to hear.
Yes. And I think it's, of course, I'm a UX researcher and designer. So my fundamental approach is that, I should know my target audience and conduct research before I create a course. And I noticed that on Udemy, it's really important that that your course should seem to be something that the student will be able to complete, you know, and can add to his or her skill set right after the course.
So sort of an immediate skill boost is sort of the concept, it sounds like.
Yes,
that's really fascinating.
Yeah, I just wanted to underline that Udemy is, for example, it targets more like a beginner level designers or maximum intermediate level designers. But yeah, this is where you have to know your target audience.
Well, that's really interesting. I hadn't known about your courses there, so we'll definitely have to get a link to them so people can check them out. I think they could be very valuable, even if you're not a user experience designer, to apply those concepts could be really valuable as another way to use the, again, you're building your skills.
Yeah.
I think you have to think about building your skills before you know how you're going to use them in some ways, right?
And I would gladly give some discounts to your listeners.
Okay. Yeah, we can talk about that and if we can include that in the show notes for sure.
Thanks.
So tell me a little bit now about the tools that you like to use. I'm always curious to hear favorite tools because inevitably sooner or later I'll discover like, oh, I didn't know about that thing and I'll try it and it fits in my workflow. So talk about your analog tools and then if you use digital tools, what are your favorite digital tools?
So I mainly use pen and paper and I would like to highlight that you don't need fancy pens or notebooks for sketching or sketchnoting. For example, throughout my Udemy course, I use the cheapest ordinary A4 size paper. Yeah, I have started using my Surface Pro for creating illustrations and sketches around 1.5 years ago. But I think that digital sketching is and is going to be just a complementary way for me. My favorite app is Concepts. It's vector-based and I can export my sketches in an SVG format and it has an infinite background. And there is a really awesome interaction inside the app. Maybe it's the UX designer speaking, but you should check it out if you don't know it. There's a huge color wheel and you can select colors from this wheel and you can spin it around. It's a great little interaction design experience. And so as for the traditional or analog things, I really love the Sketchnote Ideabook you developed. I ordered a 6-pack during the Kickstarter campaign and it's just a fantastic product. So I like to hold in my hands and the feeling of the paper, it's just really cool. And I also like these auto quill fineliner pens that I order as part of this campaign. Mm-hmm. For knowing about these pens, I mainly use the Stabilo pens, this 0.88 Stabilo pens, and I also have Pigma Micron pens, and I use Copic markers for shading.
Okay.
Yeah.
All great tools. Yeah, my funny story was when I worked with Mike on the Sketchnote Ideabook, and he wanted to add on, he had ordered lots of those marker sets, and so he had them. And he was like, hey, we have marker sets if you want to include them. And when I visited him in New York City, we spent a day together planning, and he gave me a box of them. And I took them home and I just forgot about them because it was just crazy at that time. So I got back and it was like, I don't know, 4 or 5 weeks later, I finally, oh, Mike gave me those markers. I should try those. And I was like, these are awesome. I texted him, Mike, these are amazing. I'm so sorry I didn't try these right away. So... And the thing you don't know is if you buy the 10 pack, which you can buy at Airship Notebooks website, is there's quite a variety of tips. And that was the other thing when I opened it up. There's a brush point and there's fine and there's all these different sizes, right? So it's you can experiment and find the one that you like the best. So that was really fun. I have to admit it publicly that I was such a slacker and not even opening my partner's tools and then being so excited about them when I finally did. So I'm glad that you like them. Mike will love to hear that.
and having at least two or three different sizes is really important, I think, because you need to establish a meaningful visual hierarchy and drive the viewer's attention across the page. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If it's a sketchnote or it's a layout, it's the same.
So when you do sketchnoting, do you typically have like two or three widths that you switch between when you do that? Do you start mm-hmm. with one and then emphasize later? How do you operate that way?
Yeah, if it's a live sketchnoting, for example, mm-hmm. during a conference, I only use one pen because all my mental resources I use to just keep up with the talk and capture everything I want. But if, for example, I like to create sketchnotes based on YouTube videos or the recorded meetups, and if I do that, I can always hit the pause button and I can switch pens and that mm-hmm. cover and so on. But as for live sketchnoting, I always use these Stabilo pens
only. Do you ever come back in? So if you use that whatever line you choose, do you ever come back in with a heavier line and sort of emphasize things? Or do you feel like once I'm done, I leave it alone? Or what's your mindset on that?
Mm-hmm. If we talk about live sketchnotes, sometimes I leave... empty spaces on the paper and fill them in later, usually right after the talk, if I couldn't catch something. And sometimes I cheat a little bit and create a photo with my phone during the talk. Mm-hmm. And usually I add a color to emphasize things. And for example, if I attend a conference and I create 10 or more sketch notes, usually I assign one color to one talk. Mm-hmm. And maybe it helps me recall the content better. Like, for example, I still remember that back in Web Expo, one or 2 years ago in Prague, there was a really great talk about designing a workshop and how you can think about the people and the logistics and the topic and the whole flow of the workshop. And I still remember that I assigned a red color to it. And somehow I remember the visuals better by using just one color per talk.
Mm. That's a really great tip for someone who might be listening too, to have that the color memory as well as the content memory. Something I was going to say is, Krisztina, in sketchnoting, there is no cheating. So using photos as reference, everything goes in sketchnoting, right? Because the end result is, did I capture the information to communicate? Yeah. So don't feel bad about doing that. I do that all the time. If I can find a way to make things better, I definitely do it. And I was going to mention too that I'm a big fan of concepts. In fact, one of the episodes in this series, we talked to David Britton, who's one of the co-founders of Concepts, talking about the inside details of philosophy of the app and such. So you'll probably really enjoy that. I love that app too for specific reasons. A lot of the features are really useful. Mm-hmm. And I think it's sort of underappreciated as a sketchnoter tool in some ways. Because so many people use Procreate.
Yes.
Which, you know, not to denigrate Procreate. Procreate is an awesome tool. Mm-hmm. And I guess I sort of look at each tool sort of has a little different philosophy about it. So that's a little bit of what I'm trying to capture in this series is what's the philosophy behind the tool? Because I think a lot of times, if you understand the philosophy and the way they're approaching the problem, you can better align it to the problem you're trying to solve, right? Like in your case, you said you export from concepts to an SVG file. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's very important to you. So you're the job you're trying to do, this one tool allows you to do it in a smooth way, right? Where to do it with another tool might be a problem. So it's a really useful, powerful tool. I've used it probably more for illustration work, but it's really a nice tool with so many features. It goes so deep, and then the usability is really good. So
yeah,
it's always fun to see.
And the vector based, you know.
Yes. Yeah.
Don't lose information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Everything is zoomed up and down, and you know, you can scale it. You can make a poster on a wall or on the side of a building or you know, on a business card. So that's definitely an advantage for that.
Yeah. Right.
That's good to hear. It's good to hear that you have the same perspective of that digital is in a lot of ways complementary. Mm-hmm. Like I don't see them as competing. Mm-hmm. Is that how you feel about that as well?
Yes, yes. And so for me, digital sketching or drawing was a challenge first because the friction is so different. Like of course, when I use a pen on a traditional paper, there is a certain type of friction and maybe the hand-eye coordination is also a little bit different. Mm-hmm. You have to learn or get used to it. It's a bit a slippery surface for me. I don't know how to explain it better.
No, yeah. So my solution has been using matte screen covers. The latest one I'm using is paper-like. So I think Paperlike may make one for the Surface. I'm not sure, but it provides some kind of a texture, basically. Yeah. And it also takes away the glare, which is nice for many reasons, right? So it adds just enough drag to feel more like paper with a stylus. Mm-hmm. So that might be something for you to investigate a little bit.
Yeah, thanks. I use a similar screen cover, but it's just not the same.
It's still
the good old paper and pens.
It gets closer, but you know, again, paper is still paper and ink is still ink. So hard to replicate without being that thing.
Yeah, but I can imagine why people might prefer digital sketchnoting, especially during conferences, because you can always rearrange things, or just quickly correct mistakes or duplicate icons. So I can definitely see the benefits.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
That comes back to, you know, what's your purpose, right? If you're doing it for a conference and you feel like editability or modifications are important, then maybe you should do it digitally. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, if it's just for you and you want to feel part of the joy is feeling the texture, then maybe that should be pen and paper, right? So you sort of look at the solution you're trying to achieve and then adapt the tool, pick the tool that fits it, right?
Yeah, I can tell that you are a UX designer because you always talk about the user goals and the job that the software does for the user.
Yeah, it kind of comes out like sketchnoting and visualization. So, well, Krisztina, this has been so much fun. I could just keep talking with you and, you know, maybe we'll have to have a separate call just nerding out about user experience and those kind of things. But tell people where can they find your work and see all this wonderful teaching and work. What's the best places to go to find more out about you?
Yeah, I have a newsletter and it has two main parts. One is the 100-day-long UX-related visual library building challenge. And the other one is that I regularly send out some interesting sketching-related resources alongside with my newest UX sketches. And the subscribers also can download my Sketching for UX workbook for free. Mm-hmm. And it's on sketchingforux.com. And I'm also active on Instagram. I share my sketches and other visual thinking related content, and my handle is Sketching for UX. And as you mentioned, I publish a lot of content on Medium, and my Medium publication is uxknowledgebase.com.
Okay.
And you can find me on Twitter or on LinkedIn. And I also have a Facebook group with more than 20,000 members. And
oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's a huge audience. And it's surprisingly called Sketching for UX Designers. And I am also on Udemy and Skillshare. And yeah, I try to be responsive. So if you have any questions, or your listeners have any questions, just please reach out to me.
Mm. Well, that's wonderful. We'll definitely, we'll connect up, and I'll make sure that all those links end up in the show notes, everyone, so you can go and click through and dive into the deep mines of jewels that Krisztina has for you. So, well, thank you so much. This has been a great discussion. I'm glad that I did minimal research on you. It was much more fun to hear you talk about it and then just follow up with questions. And I hope that other listeners have enjoyed that discussion as well.
Yeah, thanks so much, Mike. It was an awesome conversation.
Thank you. And for everyone listening to the show, that will wrap the show for another episode. Until the next episode of the Sketchnote Army Podcast, we'll talk to you soon. The Sketchnote Army Podcast was created by me, Mike Rohde, and brought to you by Rohde Design Studios. It's produced and edited by Alec Polianis of Amp Creative Studios. The theme music was created by John Schiedemeyer. To support the creation of this show, I invite you to buy one of my books, the Sketchnote Handbook or the Sketchnote Workbook. You can find the books on Amazon or go to peachpit.com and use the code ROADY40 for 40% off. Please share this podcast with other visual thinking friends and be sure to leave a nice rating on iTunes or your favorite podcast listening app so others can find the show.